When I was a boy of five, I floated down the Yukon River for more than 400 miles in a 26-foot poling boat with my mother and my father and my baby sister. It took about 2 weeks. We started at Whitehorse, where the Yukon River has its beginning in the froth of the Whitehorse Rapids, and we went all the way to Dawson City, where the Yukon River is joined by the romantic Klondike, a distance of about 450 miles by water. We crossed lakes such as Lake LaBarge, and we breasted rapids, and we cooked our own food, and we baked our own bread on the way. We ate porcupine stew, and we saw bears in the hillsides, and we heard the wolves howl at night. That was 20 years ago, but the Yukon River has scarcely changed since those days. It's a cold and a deadly river. It starts in the mountains of northern British Columbia, just a few miles from the Pacific Ocean. But it travels for 2,200 miles up and over the Arctic Circle and then back again before it reaches salt water at the very tip of Alaska on the cold Bering Sea just opposite Russia. It hisses, you know, like a living thing, and it boils just like boiling water because it's full of eddies and whirlpools, and when you throw a stick into it, the stick is sucked down by the undercurrent. But it's this great river that's opened up the whole of Alaska and the Canadian Yukon. Without a water highway of this kind, of course, all this enormous, empty North Country, not empty any longer, would still be as silent as the tomb. Well, we started down this river on a bright June day, and I can still remember the snow-covered peaks in the distance and the bright spring foliage and the wildflowers along the bank and the river itself swollen by the spring runoff, with logs and pieces of driftwood and whole trees torn out by the roots, all rushing along downstream beside us. Along the way, we saw old moss-covered cabins, relics of the gold rush days, perched up on the banks, and occasionally an old man living in them. I remember we stopped at one, and there was an old French Canadian in a loose blue blouse with gold earrings in his ears and a herd of goats that followed him wherever he went. And another time on June 21st, which, as you know, is the longest day of the year, we passed under a high bank, and there above us were a group of Indians dancing a dance to mark the occasion. We crossed Lake LaBarge. That's the lake that Robert W. Service made famous in his poem about the cremation of Sam McGee. And there, sure enough, was the old steamboat boiler into which Sam was supposed to have gone, because, if you remember the poem, he was from Tennessee, and he never could get warm enough in the Yukon until he jumped into this fiery furnace. There are only one or two settlements along the Yukon between Whitehorse and Dawson, but there are several isolated cabins where a family, perhaps, or only a single man, a trapper, a prospector, or a woodcutter lives. And because they live lonely lives and are always eager to greet strangers, we always stopped and passed the time of day with them. My mother baked bread on the way. To make it rise, she wrapped it in brown paper and put it under the blankets with us when we went to sleep so that the heat of our bodies warmed it. The next day, my father would scoop out an oven in a sandy bank and bake it, and it was very good, too. This Yukon is full of surprises. Sometimes, you know, the banks tower above you as high as a three-story building, and the river is very narrow. And then in other places there don't seem to be any banks at all, and the water slops over the land for 10, 20, oh, sometimes 50 miles, so that the river is as wide as a big lake. And there are other rivers pouring in to join the main river, such as the Pelly, the Stewart, and the White River, and farther down the Tanana and others. The White River is pure white, incidentally, because it's full of white volcanic ash. The most exciting moment on our river journey was when we shot the famous Five Finger Rapids. These rapids get their name because the river has been dammed by an enormous rock wall, and the water has cut five channels, like fingers, through these rocks. And the river rushes through with a great roar, and we rush through with it. It's very tricky. To get through, you've got to aim your boat directly at the middle of the biggest rock, and it looks as if you're going to smash right into it until the last moment when the current seizes the boat and whirls it off to the right, and before you can think what's happening, you're through. There's an awful lot of water in the Yukon River. The ground all around is frozen so hard all year round that the surface water can't seep down into it as it would in a warmer climate. So the water stays on the surface of the land, and all of it runs into the Yukon River, so that in flood, in the springtime, the Yukon rivals the Mississippi. For many years, engineers have been talking about using this water to convert it into electric power. But the job has been so staggering that, until very recently, nothing's been done about it. But now, a Canadian company is planning an enormous power project on the Yukon. It's quite fantastic. They're going to dam up about 300 miles of it. And they're actually going to turn that part of the river backwards and run it the other way so that they'll be able to spill it back over those mountains near the Pacific Ocean in which it rises. Then they'll tunnel down through these mountains and they'll spill the water down these tunnels to drive generators at the bottom. You know, they expect to develop 5 million horsepower in this manner, and that's twice as much as they get out of the Grand Coulee Dam project. Of course, that'll take many, many years, but it will mean a new kind of stampede to the Yukon, because, you know, there are all sorts of minerals in this country besides the Klondike gold, which will be practical to mine when they get smelters driven by hydropower up there. There's copper, lead, zinc, silver, and so on. It isn't worthwhile to mine them now. But if they do put a smelter in the Yukon and use the river to run the power for it, well, of course, they'll be able to mine these metals. And that will change the Klondike even more than the Klondike gold rush changed it. There are only, 4,000 or 5,000 white people in the Yukon at the moment. And yet, you know, the territory is almost as big as Texas. I think we can look forward to many more people in this distant part of the world in the not-too-distant future.